Thank you. Good morning, everybody. My apologies for my tardiness. I took the scenic route here. But thank you all for coming. My part is just to open this with a word of prayer. So if we could all just bow our heads and pray. Precious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, Lord, that we have this time to be able to come before you. It is always our delight and our pleasure, Lord God, whenever we have an opportunity to present ourselves to you, Lord. Father in heaven, we invite you in this place and we invite you to be part of what we are doing today in honor of a life that touched us in so many ways. We are here, Lord Jehovah God, that you'd bless this occasion, Father in heaven, as we pay our respects to an uncle, a father, a husband, a friend, a brother, and counselor, an advisor. He was so many things to so many people. But we just say thank you for that life also, Lord God, that we had the opportunity to experience it. We're so thankful for it. We believe that you expressed yourself through that life. You expressed your love through that life. And for that, Lord, we are richer. Father in heaven, Lord Jehovah God, I just commit this whole process into your hands. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Good morning. Greetings to you all. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We thank God for this wonderful day. You know, I am not really friends with cold, with winter. So I was really ready for winter. But we thank God this morning is so nice and warm. And we thank God for everything. Amen. We are here gathered together because of Se Dumisani Hlazo. But we are celebrating a life that was fully lived. So we are going to take our reading this morning from Proverbs chapter number 16, verse 4. Proverbs chapter number 16, verse 4. That's our anchor scripture, and I shall read. The Lord works out everything to its proper end, even the wicked for a day of disaster. But I like the King James Version. It says, the Lord has made all things for himself. Yeah, even the wicked for the day of the evil. Amen. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, this morning. We thank you for this wonderful day, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we are gathered together because of Se Dumisani Hlazo. Jehovah, Lord, we thank you for his life. We thank you for everything that he has done for you and for his family and for everybody. Lord, Father, we are here now, my God. Speak to us. Lord, we bless your name. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Today I have come to encourage you, or to encourage us, including myself, that we should understand that everything that God has made, he has made it for himself. When the proverb says, he has made everything, we are things in God's eyes. Yes, we are special. We are more special than everything else, but we are things in God's eyes, because he made us, he created us, and he created us for a purpose, for himself, not for ourselves, but for himself. You know, I like it when we know what our purpose is in life, and we fulfill it fully. I believe Mrs. Hlazo fulfilled his own purpose. You know, I was so overjoyed yesterday. I had a privilege. First thing is, I had a privilege of working with them. You know, we would wake up early, 6 a.m. 6 a.m., we are at the point of outreach. We are at the meeting point. We are already taking our offering. 6 a.m., and he was there. I was so overjoyed. You know, when I looked at him, I said, this man and his wife, you know, wherever he was with his wife. And they were working for the Lord together. You know, I was so encouraged and blessed. I never shared with my sister Rose that even my husband was encouraged. You know, I used to wake up. He says, where are you going now? Where are you going? Where are you going? This early is cold. But at the end, he was the one picking us from home to that point because he met Papa Hlazo there. So he was encouraged. Even after service, they would stand together, sit together, talk. And I knew that my husband is encouraged. Amen. That is a life, a purpose in life. So what I have observed, even from yesterday, is that he had a purpose. One of his friends said to us, that he was the neutralizer of everything. You know, the cool ruler. He says he was the cool ruler. He was the cool ruler. It means when he said that when he was, they were talking about something, and then when he is quiet, then they know that they have to change whatever plan it is. That was his purpose. And do you know your purpose today? Do you know yours? You know, some people, they are quiet, naturally quiet. And then when you look at them, you get bored because they are so quiet. They don't want to talk. But that is their purpose. Because there are times when you go through situations in life that needs you to be quiet, not to be too much talkative. And you solve that problem like that. You know, everywhere where you are, wherever you are. Yesterday we met another man. He was just playing a guitar and he was singing, how great you are, God. He was not talking to anybody. He was just standing by the gate and he was just singing the music. And can you imagine? Someone is going through pain. Someone is going through challenges. And then when he sings, how great you are, how great you are, God, they are so comforted. And they can smile and go home with a smile, knowing that God is great, knowing that God is all-powerful and all-present. Life, that is for a purpose. We are not just, you know, there's a man in the Bible that I read that he lived long, 963 years, if I'm not mistaken. And his name was Methuselah. But that is all what we hear about Methuselah, the long life. But we are not told what he did during those long years. The beautiful, I think he was the one who lived longest. But there's no history. All we hear is that, and he had children. And he had children. So all he did was to donate seed. But nothing else that we hear of. I don't know. Maybe there is somewhere else that is written. But the word doesn't tell us what he was supposed to do. Or what other thing that was more important. Because those people that were recorded in the Bible, they had something that was outstanding. Even if it's bad. Even if it's good. It was outstanding. And we also hear when Israel was under siege, when they were under the Babylonian captivity, it was King Cyrus who was their enemy who freed them for their first exile. It was King Cyrus. So whatever you are doing, wherever you are, whether small or great, there is a purpose in life. There is a purpose. Our problem is that we might not understand your purpose. So I'm encouraging you. You know, something happened to me several years back. I think more than 25 years ago. I'm a professional nurse. So I trained at a mission hospital, and I had asthma. So this asthma just started when I was in training. I had no family history of asthma, but it started when I was in training. And then one day I had a mild asthmatic attack. So when I was at home, I was doing everything that I could. And then my friend, my colleague at work said, "You are sick, come to hospital." I said, "No, I'm okay, I'm fine." He said, "You must come to hospital." So I went with him. Actually, he had to drag me out of the house. I went. And then when I arrived, they wanted to give me adrenaline on my chest, on the chest muscle. But it was my first time. I had never experienced that treatment. So I tried to refuse. And then they called in a chaplain. And this chaplain was my friend. She is still my friend. So they said, "She's refusing to inject, but she also injects other people." Then I just gave in. I said, "Okay, you can give me." Little did I know that that was my turning point in life. And so it was in a small booth, in a small room. So they gave me and they left. Everybody left me alone. So things started to happen. You know, I felt, you know, that fight and flight anxiety like feeling. So I knew the effects of adrenaline, that is how it works. So I thought, this is normal, I'm lying there alone. And then my heart started beating slowly. Then I got a little bit worried. I said, "Why is my heart slowing? It must be fast, because that's how it works." And then from there, then I started to breathe fast. Then I knew that now it's compensating for the slow heart. And then I started breathing very slowly. Very slowly, like I'm going to die. You know, that breathing when someone is dying, it's like you pull the breath and then you don't breathe. And then I didn't breathe. I realized that I am dying. And then whilst I was still lying there alone in that small room, closed with a closed door, I couldn't shout because it was another level. Then I realized, I saw myself, thank God, he showed me myself. I saw myself in a stretcher, and I knew they were going to take me to the mortuary. So I said to myself, "Okay, now they will call my husband that she's dead." Then I felt a little bit comfortable about it. And then I realized that, no, I don't have any report to give to Jesus. I said, "When I die now, what am I going to say to him? What?" Then I said, "I have to breathe," because I looked back. Not that I was a sinner, like sin. I would go to the pub. I was just a normal somebody, you know, but living my own life. I left my own life. I was living my own life that time. And then I said, "I have to breathe now." Oh, Rabba Sandara Yakabara Shandara Maseke Nerebu. Oh, Rakaraba Shiara Namasandaraba. Oh, Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And then I said, "I have to breathe now, or else I am going to die and I don't have any report before the Lord." So I started breathing. But you know, when I opened my eyes, the whole room was full of doctors, nurses. They were trying to stimulate me to breathe. You know, "Wake up, wake up, wake up." They were calling my name. I would hear from far that they are calling my name. So and then when I opened my eyes, then I realized that I have to do something. But you know what? Our minds, because when you are not maybe in the spirit, you don't understand very well. So I realized I have to do something, but then I did not do it that way. That very same time, I continued with my life. After the experience, it was fire in me, and then after some few months, then I continued my normal life. Until one day, I was reminded that, do you remember? You could have died that time. But what have you done so far? That was my turning point. Sometimes in life, we have turning we have different turning points. This is my own turning point. This is my own turning point. I started looking for God. That was my own turning point. But you have your own. Maybe you haven't had your own, but your time is coming. Because our God is so faithful and is so wonderful. We live for him. And you know what? From that time, I started experiencing God. And by the special grace of God, not because I'm clever, not because of anything, my parents were, they are late now, but they were local preachers. So it's not because my parents were preachers, but because of the grace of God. And he gave me the end time messages. He gave me the end time messages. Because of time, we started late. So I may not be able to give you everything. But you know what? I have decided that come rain, come thunder, whether Cape Town is cold or it's hot, I will go. I was telling my other colleague, now we are working as a team. I met this woman at a workshop. It's God who orders our steps. So I went to this workshop, and then I heard her presenting about the end time and the experiences that she was having, the divine dreams. So I said, but this is what I also get. This is what I have experienced. This I know what she... And then by the special grace, we got connected. So now we are working together. We are going around. Whether it's raining, we go out. Because we have the end time message. And this message is what I'm saying now, that we must live the purpose of life. We must fulfill that purpose. Because Jesus is coming back again. Jesus is coming back again. The Holy Spirit said, go now, go with haste, run, and tell them that Jesus is coming back again. But the thing is, when he is coming back, do you have a report? Do you have anything that you can say, I have done this? Life, we live for him. You know, I said it's better to find your purpose of existence. Each one have his own special way. Even if you are selling tomatoes at the market. Yesterday, when we arrived at Cape Town International Airport, this was our first time to come to Cape Town. So we met this man, the Uber driver. And you know, he talks. And then in his talking, he was talking about God. He was sharing with us. And it was a confirmation that God is with us. So it is the way he is supposed to carry out God's work, sharing with all the passengers that he picks them from one point to another. And then in between, he's sharing God's message. We have to be filled or fulfilled. I believe Mr. Schlazo was fulfilled. Because one thing that I realized is that in my experience with the end time message, the Lord spoke to me very well. He said, until you do this, you are not going to die. Until you fulfill what I have called you for, you are not going to die. I was so sick, I thought, take me, but until you fulfill. You have to be true to yourself. You know, many times we live a life that is not ours. Yes, it's good to emulate other people, but there are people who walk like whoever, they talk like whoever, they dress like... It's another person's life. It's not yours. Be yourself. Just be yourself. Don't pretend to be what you are not. In this end time, another message that God gave me is that people love prophecy. They love prophecy. And this end time Bible says it very well, that there will be a lot of fake of them. Because they want to deceive us. The devil will use them to deceive us. So the moment we follow them, we don't know them. Vazaluami, we don't know them. We don't know where they are getting their power from. And when we follow them, we are deceived. And at the end, we don't fulfill what God wants. So we have to be ourselves. Everybody wants to prophesy. Go to the street now. Everybody wants to prophesy, but they are not prophets. Or they are, but not all are true prophets. One thing I've realized that is we are led by the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, I will leave my spirit. And this spirit is the one that leads us. This is one thing, not that I'm bragging, but I'm trying to help us. That this is one thing that helps me. What to say, I don't care. I don't mind because I know this is not my work. So God, the Holy Spirit, will help me. He will reveal things to me. And that is what happens. So I always follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. We pray very well and we pray more than we should pray. But have you realized that some things you don't need to pray? Because the Holy Spirit is there, he just leads you. We used to fast together. Fasting like we are going to be thin. But it's not everything that you need to fast for. What is the purpose of fasting in the first place? We think that when we fast, then we bend God's arm to say, no, if I fast, then he will change his mind. No, never. Never. We fast to humble ourselves, to hear from him. So if he does not say fast, so why do you fast? Because maybe he doesn't want to talk to you now. You have to be led by the Holy Spirit. I pray when the Holy Spirit says pray. Of course, I know that it is the normal. You know what? The message that we have, that we are going around with, is a little bit different. Because we think we can do things by our own. But it's not by our own. It is by the leading of the Holy Spirit. So we always follow the Holy Spirit. You know, there's this wonderful man, Miles Monroe. He says, do not die old, but die empty. It means when God has sent you to do things, you have to complete what you have done. When you have completed, you have no purpose, and then God takes you. He takes you home. We are not afraid. I'm not afraid to die. I was telling my sister that, you know what, even if they say, go to Ukraine now, I will go. I'm sorry you are hearing it for the first time. My husband is hearing it for the first time. Because it's not about him. It's not about me. But it's all about God. Because when we present ourselves before him, he won't be there. My children won't be there. My pastor won't be there. It's me and me alone and the Lord. And then he will say, but I have sent you to do this. Have you done it? No, I did not. Because. It doesn't work that way. Verse 3 of the same chapter of Proverbs 16, it says, commit thy work unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. So we need to commit. To live a purposeful, full life, we need to commit to the Lord. Because the Lord will order our steps, and he will establish us. Verse 1 says, preparation of the heart in men, and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. So it is the Lord who prepares the heart. All we do is to submit. We give ourselves and we submit to the work of the Holy Spirit. This is the end time, and it is the work of the Holy Spirit that is working now. So we have to receive the Holy Spirit. And the last one, it says, verse 2 says, all ways of men are clean in their own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirit. Everything, you know, whatever we do, we think it's from our own mind. This scripture tells us that no, everything that we do, we can think that it is well, but it's not well. It is only God who weighs our heart. Amen. This morning, before I close, I told you that
I am an end-time revivalist. So if we don't pray this prayer, that God must help us to fulfill that purpose, to fulfill whatever, because we are not for decoration. That is true. We are not for decoration. All we need to do is to be available. And then God will just use you. My husband noticed that he is a teacher and he teaches matric. So he noticed that at his school that matric is the most challenging level of education. He lost many students during matric. Many students, they were sacked out of school during matric. Many were very sick during matric. So he started praying with them. Where as soon as they enter matric, he tells them that, you know, this level, if you are not careful, if you don't have Christ, you will not finish. So he always prays them. That is his purpose. He might not understand it. But one day God said, you don't have to understand anything. Because when Christ comes, we shall understand it all. Sometimes when things happen, then we understand, oh, this is why. This is why things were happening this way. This is why I had to meet. Sometimes it's not always, I was talking to my friend, it's not always that you meet the right people. But there's this one thing that God wants you to take from that person. So he makes you to meet those people. And then when whatever God sends them to do is over, then you separate. The separation may be very painful, but understand one thing. It is God who orders our steps. So let's all rise up and pray this one prayer. Lord, help me to fulfill my purpose. And then die. When I die, I know that you will say, enter into a rest. Because you have run at the rest, and the good fight of faith. Let's rise up and pray. Everyone, you pray for yourself. This is the end time. You don't need anyone. You pray for yourself. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Jehovah, Spirit of the living God, as we are here, Lord, gathered at this occasion, my Father, speak to me, Lord. Speak to my life, my God, that I may have the revelation of my purpose, that I may fulfill, that I may live a full life in you, Lord, oh my God. Father, I pray that the Holy Spirit will be in me, the Holy Spirit will fill me and will guide me in the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord, for this wonderful time, oh God. Thank you, Lord, for our different turning points, my God. Because of your purpose, they shall be fulfilled in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. In Jesus' name, you can take your seats. And I pray that your lives shall be fulfilled in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Grace. I think it's listening to what you were saying. It's in listening to how Mandla opened in the prayer, describing the various roles or the various things that Uncle Du was to so many people. I would agree with you that he had certainly found his purpose. And lived his purpose in life. I was actually looking at the pictures. You know, yesterday, Antarosa said, you know, there's going to be a presentation playing, and it's going to be showing, you know, Uncle Du traveled a lot, and you'll be able to see the pictures of all the different places he went. And I used to think that the colonel over there is the most traveled amongst us, but looking at these pictures, Antarosa, I think you're right. Looks like Uncle Du traveled all over the place, more than anybody else. And I'm sure he touched the lives of the various people that he made and relationships he made along the way. Continuing today with the program, next we're going to ask Ukulu Muntunai to come up and say a few words on behalf of the Hlazo family.
Ndiyazehlisa phakathi kwalendlu yenkonzo, ndizehlisa kuni nonke nakumphathi wetheko, ndihlonipha ngenxa yesikhathi esiphakathi kwaso esikadumisana Hlazo oselele. Ndithanda ukwazisa ukubana loo ndoda ibingunyana kum, kodwa sikhule sonke ngokuba izalwa ngumkhuluwa wam. Indlela besiphila kuyo ibintle kakhulu. Ndiphile naye eGwelu, ndawuphila naye kwaBulawayo, ude kwafika ixesha lokuba ephakama esuka kwi-airport yakwaBulawayo eZimbabwe esiza kweli cala. Kungako ke fike ithuba lakhe lokwedlula emhlabeni bekulixesha elibi, ilixesha leCOVID, kwaphakama umkhulu wakhe uZweli kuphela. Sonke sasala ngenxa yelo xesha. Kungako ke ndiphakama ke ndisitsho ukubana hayi, lala kakuhle noZulu. Sonke sibe nawe, khange sibe nangxaki. Ubungumntu obongeneka ubudleka, ebengumntu obethobekile, ubengumntu ebenovelo, ebengumntu omaziyo omnye umntu. Kungako xa nditshoyo andithuki, nditsho ke ndithi lala kakuhle qhawe noZulu Mpafana Thukela Mpangazitha. Uba sawuhlangana kwelizayo. Inkosi mayibusise. Amen.
Siyabonga tata. Next, I'm going to ask Unomathemba to come up and speak, representing all the nieces and nephews.
Good morning, Aunt Rosie, the Hlazo family, Bengu, Takawira families, and all relatives and friends. Uncle Dumisani, to us, nieces and nephews, we will miss hearing your signature greetings, Unjani Mshana Wami. Uncle Du was such a remarkable man. He was very popular and loved by his nieces and nephews. We all found our way to him, be it for help, advice, relaxing, or just for a good laugh. He was full of humor and at all times made sure he left you cracking and laughing. It was never a dull moment around him. He was a magnet that kept us together. As most of us here today went through his hands one way or the other, when I wanted to move to Cape Town a couple of years ago, Uncle Du and Aunt Rosemary were my pillars until I could stand on my own. He had a very soft spot for his nieces and nephews, and today we bid him farewell, knowing we were all loved and cherished by him. He had a specific, unique ways with each and every one of us, which enabled strong bonds with him. We all felt at home around him. Most importantly, he was full of wisdom, hence he was our go-to person in times of turmoil. We all have been shattered by Uncle Du's early passing. He left a huge void amongst us that no one can fill. Uncle Dumisani Hlazo, you will forever be engraved in our hearts. Thank you.
Thank you, Noma. Next, I'm going to ask Mark McLean, worked with Uncle Du at the Cape Town International Airport, to come up and speak. Thank you, Mark.
Good morning, all. My name is Mark McLean, and I'm the general manager of Cape Town International Airport. So, just also standing next to me is Ms. Jody van Wyk, and she's was with us for many, many years. She was also a manager at our airport and worked very, very closely with Dumisani. So I think firstly, Rose, just Tommy, so it's absolutely a pleasure to come and speak on behalf of the airports company and of our team to just say a few words about Dumisani and about what he meant for us and for our business. So just thank you for affording me that opportunity. So for me personally, when I arrived at Cape Town International Airport in 2006, Dumisani was there. And he was the airfield manager at the time, and Jody was the safety manager at the time. And I started as the maintenance engineering manager. But so when I joined, I knew nothing about airports, not a single thing. And so it was very daunting because it was a very new place to be in. But I quickly found out that I was delighted that Dumisani was there because he knew everything about aviation and about the airfield at the time. And it's very fitting that he's got this attire. So when I got there, I needed to do many things. I needed to refurbish the runway. I needed to learn about the airfield in a short space of time, and I found Dumisani to be extremely helpful, extremely supportive, and I found him to be very smart. He was articulate, he was technically strong, and I think he was the one who I felt knew everything about every aircraft, every aeroplane. He knew standards and regulations well. He was all about compliance. So if you wanted to know anything, and if you weren't sure about the rules, and you wanted to make sure you were doing exactly the right thing, you must ask Dumisani. He'll keep you out of trouble. So for me, and in partnership with Dumisani, and I think all of us with Dumisani, we shared a great mutual respect. We were a great team at the time. And for me, Dumisani will always be special because I soon found out that he also shares a birthday with my eldest sister. So I never forget Dumisani's birthday, and I hear that we're celebrating this occasion just after his birthday yesterday, so how fitting. But for me, also the legacy we built with him was that he helped us build that fantastic terminal and those facilities that you come through at Cape Town International Airport. He was part of that. He helped us go through a Soccer World Cup in 2010. He was part of that. We welcomed the U.S. president together. We prepared for Madiba's funeral together. So we did a fantastic many things, and that's part of his legacy. But we also weathered lots of storms, eh? We had holes in runways that he needed to attend to, air bridges of damaging aircraft that he had to attend to. But we were always partners. And I felt that, with Dumisani next to you, you always had a little bit of extra confidence that you were going to deal with a thing in the right way and that you were going to get it right. And Dumisani was extremely also passionate about fine rescue. I don't know, Dumisani must have written a million motivations to management about fine rescue. He was always writing something about too little staff or too little people. And I found that, he was passionate about people, and he wanted to make sure that his staff was taken care of. And I always used to say, Dumisani, you're a man of great perseverance and motivation. Keep going, keep going. But, your dad loved the aviation business. He spent 40 years in the industry. He described himself as an airfield specialist, I think he calls himself. Yeah, but we know him as an aviator. And that's how people fondly refer to to Dumisani. And then he was a man who never stopped studying. Yeah, I know every evasion course he used to try and do. He did his EDP at Henley. I think he was at Queensland University. He does his master's, his MBA there. And he never stopped studying and improving himself. But his career, I recall, he started air traffic control. At air traffic control. And then he went to, I think, airport manager of Polokwane. He spent some time there. And then he came to Cape Town International Airport. He went to Oliver Tambo. And then he decided that he was going to do something on his own. And he started his own business. And I'm very sorry that, he was not able to see that business through. Because I felt that it was just starting to grow. You know, he was starting to get tenders. He was starting to expand the business. And he had a willingness to take on new challenges. And I knew that his knowledge and his skills were highly respected in the industry, and he built a great name for himself while he was in the industry. I think one of the highlights was he won the Top Gun Award in 2017, where the community at Oliver Tambo International Airport awarded Dumisani with the Top Gun Award for his fantastic contribution that he made to the stakeholders, to the customers in the industry. And I thought that was very fitting of who he was, because it was always about giving to the people, making sure that our customers and our stakeholders were taken care of. So I'm really sorry, that, because I know the last chats that I had with Dumisani was that he was just excited about starting to see his business grow. And I know he would have made a fantastic contribution or continued contribution to the industry in the work that he was doing. But let me also just say a little bit about who he was and who we saw him to be as a person. I think I mentioned hardworking, passionate about his work. His staff described Dumisani as a great leader, and they described him as a person who always allowed them to excel, and for allowed them to be their best. He believed in them. He supported them. And those are the words that I received from his team. And when someone was promoted, certainly when I was promoted, Dumisani would be the first person to congratulate. So he took a joy in other people's success. And I know him to be that individual. But yeah, he was soft spoken, but he had a very distinctive voice, right? Yeah, when Dumisani calls, it's Dumisani that's on the phone. So I'm gonna miss his voice. And then he also used to have a sense of humor and a quirky way of doing things, and a smart quirky way. When we had problems, he would say, "Mark, let's start thinking about maybe doing something about this problem." I said to Dumisani, "What are you talking about?" Anyway, I'd say to Dumisani, Dumisani never wanted to smile in a photo. I said, "Dumisani, smile," and then you get some weird, quirky. The most you get is a naughty smirk out of him. But Dumisani for me was a deeply caring man. And when we spoke to him and when he used to send messages, he'd always end off with things like, "Thanks for caring," or he'd end off his messages with, "God bless you." And you'd never call without asking, "How's your family?" I'd always say, "Yes, everything is good, but how's the wife? How's the kids?" And in my heart, I knew that he was always someone that could be trusted and could be depended on. We always knew that he had a warm heart, and it was always a pleasure for me to be in his company. I was recalling this morning that he always wore this brown khaki jacket that he so loved, and when we were at functions, I would really enjoy sitting as close as possible to do Masani. So I recall the Hosen family to Masani with a great deal of fondness, and just thank you to do Masani, who's looking down on us from above, and certainly to the family for the immense contribution to all of us, our business, our industry, and for changing our lives for the better during the time that he was with us. He was an absolutely great man that we lost far too soon, and we wish you all the best and comfort, and may Dumasani rest in peace. Thank you.
So, Marcus has covered quite a bit, and Rose asked me this morning, do you want to say something? And I said, no, I'm not going to deal, so I'm going to be quick. when I started 2 years before Mark did, and I started in the security position, security manager, and there was always lots of things happening. And the one thing that I recall was the fact that we went on an ops breakaway, and I was the only female in the midst of all of these other boys. And I was like, my goodness, you know, this is going to be a bit challenging. And the boys are extremely naughty as it goes. So between Dumasani and I was saying, there's a beautiful picture of Dumasani and Abdul. They would be together and be conspiring, and I would be thinking, what are you thinking of doing? You know, what is happening? And then they would just be all gentlemanlike, you know, around me, and like nothing is going to happen, but they would be very, very naughty. And that was my first impression of Dumasani as an individual, that he was fun-loving, but he was a complete and utter gentleman. From a woman's perspective, a complete and utter gentleman. And as time passed and as we changed positions in the airport, I took over safety. He went into the airfield space. And the one thing I recall was this issue around the risk register. So we have a risk register that would have to be updated. The team hated updating this register because it was always what goes into the register. But Dumasani would come there consistently with one particular risk that he wanted rated the highest out of all of the other risks, and he would fight for it passionately. He would say, if the airport goes down, and if there's a massive crash on the airport will be closed for days on end, and it's going to be catastrophic, and it has to be the top risk, it has to be the number one risk. And for years, he kept winning that battle. So Dumasani was very consistent, and I must say that when I was advised of his passing, I was very, very deeply saddened. Caught, like in most people, very unaware of it. But Dumasani was such a gentle soul, and he will be truly and utterly missed, and he is being missed. But I want to say to Rose that there was one function, and it was the first time that I met you, and I fell in love with you, and I realized why Dumasani is who he is, because you and he are one, and that beauty which you have emanates through him. So Rose, I want to say thank you for blessing us with such a beautiful man, with such a loving and caring individual. And to the rest of the family, we express our deepest condolences, and we're giving you our greatest love, knowing that a giant has fallen. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Mark and Jody for those lovely words and those anecdotes from work. I could actually picture some of the things that you were saying, particularly the phrase about, let's think about, possibly thinking about doing something. I absolutely hear him saying that. Next, we're going to call on Asni from the church in Pretoria to come up and say a few words. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you for inviting me, Rose. I'm going to read a letter from our evangelism team in Pretoria. A letter to a real man of God. Dumisani, the first time I looked up when you and Rose entered into the room on evangelism, I really felt that a pastor walked into the room. A lot of authority, but I felt the humility in you and the love of Christ when you came and greeted me after the first class on evangelism. A true servant of Christ Jesus and lived for our kingdom, for his kingdom. It is a true blessing to have known you, and sometimes I wished we had met sooner. You were not talking too much, but you did do the walk. That is how I summed you up. You were a man of integrity, husband to your wife, and a true father to your children. Thank you that you served in the evangelism team with such loyalty and humility. Thank you for the dedication to the lost souls and God's plan in your life. Today, I know you leave a legacy behind to Rose and your children. I know they will walk and complete the journey you have started. Today, you are in the kingdom of heaven and talking to Jesus face to face and singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." If I think of a Bible verse that summed you up in your life, I'm getting the following, Isaiah 61, verse 3, from the Amplified. So they're called the trees, so they will be called the trees of righteousness, strong and magnificent, distinguished for integrity, justice, and right standing with God, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. See you one day, my friend, Peter Stain, Bespoke Word Ministries. I'm just going to change my notes, sorry, that is from our Bespoke Word Ministries in Pretoria, where we did evangelism with Dume and Rose. This is from me personally to you, Rose, in Nondo and Dumisani. I thank you very much for allowing me to come here and to speak to you on this day. Dearest Rose, Dumisani's best earthly friend, I've seen and felt the heart with which you miss him, and my heart breaks for you. I pray the Lord heal your broken heart, as is his promise in Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is close to those who are of a broken heart and saves such as are crushed for sin and are humbly and thoroughly penitent. Dearest Nondo, Dumisani's little lady, a very special lady, and I know you shared a dear closeness with your dad. I pray the Lord will walk with you daily and that you remember that you can trust him. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and the starry host by the breath of his mouth. He is trustworthy. Dearest Dumi, I don't see you, but I will read it to you. Dumisani's little man, I know you miss him dearly, and I pray the Lord comfort you in a special way always, and that you both, Nundu and Dumi, will know Jesus the way Dumisani did in his earthly life. It is a great privilege and honor for me to be here and to speak to you. I met Dumisani very recently, the last 3 or 4 years, and what I can say about Dumisani, I have said a few people, and it's already been said quite a lot. And you have people in life who make a lot of noise and babble throughout their days, and you get those who speak their words, and their words live with you forever. I think you all know which one Dumisani was. When I was still new at evangelism, I was privileged to lead his group, and the first thing he said to me was, wherever you have two people, you will have politics. Why am I mentioning this? Because it's the deciding factor for me every day of my life. Whether I'm at home or at work or at evangelism, I take a step back and decide, wait a minute, that one thing, is it my politics? Is it their politics? Where are we going here? And how can we achieve this together rather than deciding my politics is greater? So this brings to mind a verse which I would like to leave with you, which helps me to think of Dumisani as well, how he made things very clear for us when we had decisions to make. I don't know,
I don't know that version of let's think about thinking about. But I know the other version. One word and it kept me straight, boy. I think that's what I needed. And he was just the right person at the right time. Jeremiah 6:16 says, stand by the roads and look and ask for the eternal paths where the good old way is. Then walk in it and you will find rest for your souls. I'll leave you with the thought of what we were taught at evangelism to ask, if you died today, where will you be, in heaven or in hell? Why am I asking you this? Because I believe if Dumi was here, he would ask you that one final question. Again, I read the verse, Jeremiah 6:16. Stand by the road and look and ask for the eternal paths where the good old way is, then walk in it and you will find rest for your souls. We know without a shadow of a doubt where we will find Dumisani. Only question is, will you join him there? God bless. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Esni. Next, I'm going to ask Vuyo also from the Pretoria Church to come up and say a few words. Where's Vuyo? Okay. Thank you.
Good morning, Moloini. I mean, for me, really, you know what, the moment I saw Dumi and my sister Rosie, you know, in our evangelism class, you know, for some reason, you know, I admired their unity because wherever you see them, they were together. And, you know, for some reason, you know what, I just loved their spirit, their sweet spirit, you know. You know, they didn't even say much in class. You know, you get those people who are always talking in the, you know, in the meetings or in the class, you know, asking questions or commenting. But, you know, their gentleness, quietness, but deep, you know, there was something about them, you know, that I just liked. You know, I was just, you know, drawn, you know, to them. And, you know, for instance, you know what, we would have, you know, the outreaches in the evenings. I remember when we had one in a shopping mall, I was, you know, assigned, you know, in Dumi's group, you know, where he was, it was led by Esne. So, and then, you know what, you know, for some reason, you know what, when we were walking in the mall, you know, approaching, you know, the shoppers, telling them about Jesus, you know, with Dumi, there were times that, you know, I would feel discouraged, you know, people just, you know, wouldn't even want to talk to you when you, you know, approach them greeting, you know, trying to tell them about Jesus. They'll just say, no, I'm in a hurry, you know, going around, you know, about their business. You know, I'll just, you know, there was one evening, I just, you know, found a bench, you know, and then I just sat down. I said, you know, because I just thought to myself, I'm not effective, but, you know, Dumi, with his gentle spirit, he'll actually, you know, he'll never sit down. He'll just walk, keep walking. And you know what, for some reason, you know what, I mean, I wouldn't even hear what he was telling, you know, I mean, that individual. But for some reason, you know, people will listen. He'll just be so gentle, and then he'll just talk, you know, with that person, and you know, for some time, and then the next thing, you know, he's writing down, you know, they are sharing, you know, contacts. I would say, I mean, you know, this brother is not, you know, I don't even hear his loud voice, but he's so effective, you know. But you know, all I say is that, you know what, you know, this couple, you know, I mean, for me, they became, you know, my friends, my family. I mean, to me, I took him as my big brother, you know. So really, you know, Rosie, Sana, you know, I am so glad that, you know, I was connected with you divinely, because, you know, I've learned so much from this couple, and I thank God for Dumi's life. It was well lived, you know. I learned a lot, you know, from you, you know, even, you know, without you saying much, you know, I've learned so much, you know, from you, you know, and you know what, my love, you know, for the people to out, you know, for the outreach, it grew through meeting you. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been at the level that I am. Now, you know what, I just have that the desire just to go out to the, you know, outreaches, orphanages, you know, and all that. You know, your life has had an impact on mine. You know, thank you for sharing your beautiful heart with your husband. You know, he was just, you know, a gentleman, you know, quiet but so effective. You know, I'm so glad, you know, I'm so grateful for his life and your lives. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next, I'm going to ask Mr. Steve Skoko, Uncle Du's childhood friend from Gweru, come up and speak.
Good morning. I got a speech which I want to read. Nothing's written. Because our friendship with Dumsani, you can't write it. Yeah. I know all of you, you want me to say, oh, his best friend from childhood, all the naughty part of it. Yes, like all child, we were naughty. I agree. I first met Dumsani, I think I was about 7 years old, in Gweru, a church called St. Matthew's Anglican Church, where he used to come with his brother, wearing some funny, to us at that time it was funny, was wearing you know, English type of dressing, long socks, short trousers with a bow tie. To us it was a very funny way of dressing. We used to tease them and said, "Hey, what type of dressing is that?" Without knowingly, Dumsani would be my friend. Our friendship was made in heaven. I was 3 years older than Dumsani. We were playing, we were 8 boys used to play. My father was a subdeacon. We used to play with Robert, his father was the priest in charge. Then Dumsani, his father was Mkosa, a layman. Then Paul Chando, his mother was a leader of the church women's league. Then Thompson, he was not an Anglican. We were doing all sorts of funny things. You know, when you are growing up, you're a teenager, you're naughty and all those funny things. But there's one thing special about Dumsani. If we see him quiet, we automatically know we have to change what we are doing at that particular time. You'll just switch off and watches you. Sometimes he hums, looking at you as if he's not seeing you. He won't tell you to stop it or what, but you switch off. First of all, we used to ignore him, but we learned something. No. We used to call him the co-ruler. To me, I was one of the noisiest of them all, the naughtiest of them all. Talk of anything, I was the number one. But Dumsani was my pillar to be what I am today. My family, to be what they are today, it's because of Dumsani and his wife. They were my pillar. They would tell me some of the things I was doing, that this is bad, stop it. Well, sometimes I used to listen, sometimes no, but I listened to some of the things. It made my family to be what they are, my children. to be what they are today, it was because of Dumisani. He helped me by upbringing my children, encouraging me to be a father. Well, you know, when you start drinking, sometimes you forget that you go home. You leave in the morning, you'll be back the next 3 days, maybe you do. But Dumisani will tell you, no, it's not done that way. You must go back home. Actually changed my life. Yes, I would go and drink, but at 9 o'clock, my mind tells me, Dumisani says that, I'm going home. He was a pillar. My daughter, they used to phone me every time. What are you doing about Vuyo? I said, she's a woman, she will get married, I'll get to Lobola and forget about it. He says, no. Take your child to school. Vuyo, because they were always want something me to do about Vuyo. I said, oh. They were in Durban. I went to Durban. I said, I came all the way from Zimbabwe. I want you people to give me the address of that school. I took my daughter to here in Cape Town. Today she's working for Ministry of Legal Justice and Parliamentary Affairs. If it wasn't for Dumisani and Rosemary, my daughter by now would be, I don't know. But she's somebody in this world. He was a pillar, a well-loving person, a person who you love to listen. You cannot separate Dumisani with love. You can't separate Dumisani with, you know, I have no words to say. You are somebody who are so special. That's why our friendship was tailor-made by God himself. Until today, to be what I am today, it was Dumisani. If I didn't listen to some of his words to stop us to do some naughty things, maybe I would be in jail. I never went to jail because it was Dumisani. Because he would control us. He would tell us, please, don't do this. He was a one-man person, he talks once. The next time, he switches off. What type of person do you love? Today, I'm here to celebrate his love. To stand in front of you, it's an honor which I will never get in my lifetime. To have a friend like him. He was a dearly, to me, he was my brother. Somebody who actually groomed me. Remember, I was 3 years older than him. I was supposed to be I trying to groom him to be somebody in the world. But no, it was vice versa. He used to, even the way he tells you, he'll tell you in such a way you listen. So I've missed a brother. A brother. Some of us, we can say a brother, somebody who comes with from my same father, same mother. But it was more than that to me. More than that. Well, I don't know. Maybe we'll meet again in the next world. But you are somebody special to me. In a way, I can't express it to you. May his soul rest in peace.
Thank you, Mr. Skoko. Next, I call Cynthia Trosi's sister to come up and speak for a bit. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Saying goodbye to Uncle Du is one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. I am Cynthia, his sister-in-law. And on behalf of my family, I would like to thank you all for coming. Uncle Du was many things to most people, a brother, a father, an uncle, a friend, a colleague, a mentor. But above all of that, he was my sister's husband. And for the past couple of months, I've been trying to make sense of why this happened, why he was taken away from us so suddenly. And perhaps Dumsani was too good for us, and he went on to do bigger and better things in his afterlife. Uncle Du was much more to us than just a brother-in-law. To me, he was my big brother. To my parents, he was an exceptional son-in-law. And he was like one of their own. And he fit perfectly with our family. He was a true brother. If you have ever wondered if the expression, a brother from another mother, actually makes sense, it does. I experienced it with him. We experienced it with him, all my siblings. He was truly a brother from another mother. And he was Rosemary's perfect ending, a happy ending. To Tami and Nondumiso, he was the best dad. He was their superhero. However, unfortunately, we will forget the things he said. We are going to forget the things he did. But we will never forget how he made us feel. And to Uncle Du, I just want to say, Hamba kahle, keswa amaZulu. Lala kahle, keswa. And uyakhatha zeki, umdeni wakho, uyazigcina. Farewell to a perfect gentleman, my brother.
Cynthia, that was a perfect isiZulu from you there. Next, we're going to have a poem from TK Biza, Uncle Du's nephew.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of the Lord. The name of the poem is called Storyteller. Let me tell you a story about a storyteller, the legend, Dumsani Hlazo, a.k.a. Uncle Du. He wasn't a great man because he built statues or changed government policies or ended world hunger. He was great simply because he could form great personal relationships with every soul he ever connected with. Like a suit tie, he had a joke and a story to fit every occasion and a cheeky smile to match. He traveled the world, met so many people, achieved his dreams, and conquered most of his fears. And he always held out a helping hand. He gave extra. He went the extra mile. He defined extra. That's why he is extraordinary. He cemented his legacy in our hearts. And with that, he taught me to laugh through the pains of life. He taught me to be spontaneous and compassionate, never to write off anyone just because the world has, to accept people the way they are, because you don't know their story until you know their story. He also taught me one thing. Don't ask too many questions. Always ask the right questions. Otherwise, it's osala. And with this, his chapter draws to a close. But in heaven, his story continues. Thank you.
Thanks, TK. We have a couple of messages from two people who couldn't be here today. So Wimbai, Uncle Du's niece, will come up and read those two messages.
Good morning, everybody. May I just start by greeting Pastor Grace and to Rosie, family and friends. Thank you so much for coming. I'm going to read two messages, and I was really hoping that Lindsay was going to read her eulogy first so that she could start the train of crying, and I wouldn't. But let me just read these two messages. The first one is from Mr. Tsietsi, who was Uncle Du's partner. Unfortunately, he couldn't make it on time. And it reads, I met Mr. Hlazo about 3 years back through a common colleague from aviation, Mr. Essery Hamilton. Ever since that day, Dumisani and I had been talking daily, trying to pursue some business opportunities. Only 3 months later, after knowing each other, we finally met in person. Dumisani was an extremely humble man of God. He had a wonderful sense of humor and was a teacher of note. When I met Dumi, I had no clue about anything about airports. The only thing I knew more was hustling for business on the streets of aviation. My wife knew Dumisani very well because every morning it would be him and I on the phone discussing how best to change aviation in South Africa. He was very patient with the country's aviation standards and believed that very soon things would change for the better. Dumi was a comforting voice when I needed an angel to speak something that my heart needed. Every time I gave reports that we were not appointed for a certain business that we tried, he would comfort me and remind me that patience was the key to success in aviation. He kept on telling me that God will open doors very soon. I grew up without a father and never knew the value of family as a pillar until I met Dumi. Every time we talked, Dumi would ask me, "Tsietsi, unjani umndeni?" Through him, I learned about the importance of being a man in my house. I honestly, to this day, believe that Dumi was the answer to my prayers for a guiding angel. Now I know better about being a man and about being a husband to my wife. While I was celebrating our collaboration, suddenly the voice I used stopped. Suddenly, I was told that Dumi had passed on and was even buried. That left me disorganized, angry, and sad because I lost a brother, a father, and a mentor. Sis Rosemary, I can tell you that your husband is in heaven, sitting next to Jesus Christ, because I know that he achieved the rule of John 3:3 while on earth. One day, you will be united with him. It is well in my soul. I hope soon you will find your peace. And this is Tsietsi Tsakhai, who is the CEO of Konka Aviation. The last message that I'm reading is from Tari, and it reads, "Morning, Auntie. I'm up early, just thinking of you and my cousins and the day ahead. I pray God covers you and you send off your bestie in peace and love. When you fall short, remember him always. He was kind and patient. He was always sympathetic and loving. He was Mr. Hlazo, and he stood for what was right. In his softness, he was well aware of people who were not always for the truth or just in their bad ways, yet he never discriminated. He loved truly, and anyone who would go to him would always feel heard, no matter what the circumstances. I loved my Malume, truly, and I know he loved me. I remember when I had a fungal infection, and he told Mom to bring me to Bulawayo. Then they took me to the doctor. 2 days later, Malume said, 'Ai Tari, doctor says your condition was so bad, they had to manufacture a treatment just for you.' At that time, it was funny, because he was drunk, but Malume got to be the savior. He was even more amazing. When I got to England, I'd always call him and tell him I wanted to come back. And he would tell me that nothing comes easy. Stick to it. For a few months, and then if I failed, then I must tell him. I never told him I failed, or passed, or just survived. After Peter's wedding, we would talk. He would send me scriptures. And the last time I spoke to him was when he wanted to speak to you, but he couldn't get to you. And Phil added him. He said, 'I wish my sister was here to see you guys. I love you all and appreciate how you've always made sure I'm your Malume.' This is something Uncle Du said. I miss him so much, but can only imagine your loss." Tami and Nono, last but not least, I pray this day is filled with joy and love. In remembrance of who he was, my 21st key only came from him. Even though Mom had got me something small and private, I remember how happy I was when I got that big key. I love you, Auntie. God keep and protect you.
and give you peace that passes understanding. You are all loved. Thank you.
Thank you, Mbai. Thank you to Tarif and Mr. Tietze for those lovely messages. Okay, from here we're going to proceed to the site where we're going to lay Uncle Du's ashes. I think we'll just follow Mandla and Auntie Rosie. They'll show us the way where we're going. Just a matter of housekeeping. The bathrooms are at the back for anyone who needs to use the bathroom. And then I think we'll have some, after we've finished proceedings at Uncle Du's resting site, we'll have a little bit more information about where we can grab a bite to eat and then where we're proceeding after that. So, Mandla, if you want to come up.
khona inhloko. So I didn't ask what this logo is, but then I couldn't hold my curiosity because he was inviting so many people, not only in the hotel, but wherever we met somebody in the street. You said, Saturday, please come over to the airport, Connie Logo. So I said, this logo, what logo is this? I didn't know about this logo ceremony. So I say to him, tell me, bro, let logo in logo Antoni, what is it? What is a goat's head? And then I was wondering, I didn't ask any more questions. But I had so many questions in my head. If it's a goat's head, he's invited over 20 people already to eat one goat's head. What is this all about? And anyway, lo and behold, Saturday, cars started driving into the yard, and people sat around here. And Adirozi came with a tray with a small goat's head on it and a knife. I said to myself, wow. I mean, I can polish this on my own. And Dumiz asked 20 people or more to come and... And it was very funny, you know, everybody would cut a piece and have a piece there, and people were drinking and were having fun. And people started saying their goodbyes, and then Dumi said, just hold on people, just before you go, I've got something else for you. And then he rushed back into the house, came back again with another goat's head. And then, you know, the gathering was extended for another 2-3 hours. Around about 3 p.m. people started saying their goodbyes. You know, I didn't think much about it then, you know. But when I was alone, when I was back in Harare, I thought about it. I said, the ceremony really wasn't about eating a goat's head. The ceremony was about getting people together. You know, that spirit of getting people together. And I can never forget it. It was so long ago, but it was always lingered in my head. And then another experience was when my wife burnt herself. Well, not burnt herself, but she had an accident and had a pot of boiling oil. It slipped and it burnt her leg. So I wrote to me a letter, you know, I sent him a message. Because I'm taking Usisconi to the hospital because she got burnt. And he wrote back to me, he says, hey, Puti, I gave you that wife in trust. And if you can't take good care of her, I'll come there and take her with me back to Pretoria. I said to myself, well, I wish I hadn't told him, you know? But, you know, he was just that kind of man. And, you know, as we say, bid him goodbye, I would like to extend my thanks to him for the lives he touched, for the indelible memories that he has left us all with. And as we go back and get further guidance on the way forward, I thank you all for your time, for your patience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm not dancing away too much. So we can now proceed back to the table just under the tree there. There are some takeaway packs.
Ha, 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 ha